What can I buy with this much? Believe it or not, quite a lot. G'day guys, JJ here, and today I'm gonna be telling you how you can travel on a budget and save money while you're traveling so that you can use those extra dollars on experiences, adventures, wildlife encounters, whatever you want in 2021 and beyond. In this video, I'm gonna show you how I saved hundreds, even thousands of dollars with these five top money-saving tips. Let's get into it now. If you are familiar with my channel, you'll know my travel style is wildlife, adventure, and everything in between. If you're not familiar with my channel, there's never been a better time, so be sure to subscribe down below. Now, travel is often pegged as expensive, and I'm fully aware that now is not the best time to be traveling overseas, but nearly all of these tips I've actually used right here at home in Australia over the last 12 months, and even over the last couple of years, to save a bunch of money. So definitely don't diss using them in your home country, and I'll try to give a few examples from here at home and abroad. Tip number one is cut costs on the essentials. There are some things we need when we travel, or to even stay alive. Those are food, water, a bed, a roof over our head. You simply can't avoid these things. But the way I've been able to afford so many unique and unforgettable experiences while traveling is by cutting costs on these essentials. Accommodation. We all know accommodation prices can vary massively while traveling. I've personally stayed in places maybe as expensive as $300 a night. I know it certainly goes much higher than that. I've also stayed in places as cheap as $10 a night. That's a pretty big difference. The way I see it, I just need somewhere clean, safe, with a pillow to lie my head on at night, and if it's got those things, I'm willing to give it a crack. Now, I do understand that some people may be a little nervous about booking accommodation as cheap as $10 per night, but the biggest tip I can give on that is to check out the reviews. Head to booking.com or Google and actually read through those reviews. They've rarely steered me wrong, and you can see if that accommodation has exactly what you want. Included breakfast, maybe it's a bit of a party hostel if you're into that kind of thing. Take the time to read those reviews and you'll rarely go wrong. Now, one of the best ways to save money on accommodation is by staying in hostels and backpackers. Now, these are places where you can meet heaps of like-minded travelers, and you can stay in a dorm that may have 4, 6, 8, 12, one time even 22 people. You'll also be sharing communal areas like bathrooms, showers, and kitchens. But if you embrace that lifestyle, you will save a ton of money, and I've made some pretty good mates over the years meeting them in hostels. In places like Malaysia and Indonesia, I was getting the cheap ones. I could easily find somewhere to stay that was $10 to $20 a night. And even if you want to upgrade in somewhere like Indonesia, Bali for example, Airbnbs are super cheap as well. In Australia, hostels start from between $30 and $40 a night. And yes, I do regularly stay in hostels here in Australia. I often get questioned by international travelers, why are you staying in a hostel? Why are you backpacking through parts of your own country? The reason is, it's cheap. The majority of Australian hostels are at an extremely high standard as well. And I've stayed in places as cheap as $30 to $40 a night. When I was down in Port Lincoln, swimming with sharks and swimming with sea lions, that's quite an expensive activity. I stayed in the YHA down there for around $30 a night. Another way to do it cheap, which is easiest in your home country, is to go camping. Here in Australia, I can find places as cheap as a couple of bucks a night. Some you can even find that are free. Now, next is food. Oh, how good is food? Tell you what's better than food, cheap food. And most of the time you don't have to compromise on delicious, tasty, glorious food. One example, if you've been to Southeast Asia, you know how incredible that street food is, but it's also stupidly cheap. Most of the time while I was backpacking through Malaysia, my daily breakfast was roti canai and a kopi tarik. So roti is of course like a bread. In Malaysia, they do it a bit differently. It's quite thin, it's fried. And you just have like a bit of curry sauce or sambal, like chili paste that you dip it in. That cost 30 cents. And then I had a coffee, which has got the condensed milk down the bottom. That was another 30 cents. And that would keep me going for most of the day. My mouth's drooling a little bit just thinking about it. If you try to embrace street food while you're traveling, you will not only save a bunch of money, you'll be able to really immerse yourself in the food culture of that country. I guarantee you will try things that you probably never would have tried if you played it safe and just hung out at the Western restaurants. A hot tip for trying street food or eating in these large outdoor eateries is to go to the places that are fairly crowded. That way you know the food is probably good, but it is also safe. Hostels will often include breakfast, so have your breakfast there. If it's included, eat as much as you possibly can so you don't have to eat too much or pay too much for food later in the day. You can grab an extra, you know, piece of fruit, an extra banana or two, chuck them in your pockets so you can snack throughout the day, and it's all included in that price you've already paid for your hostel. Another tip is to buy food from grocery stores and prepare and cook it up yourself rather than eating out all the time. This is something that is very, very important here in Australia where food prices are quite high. If you're staying in a hostel, they'll often have a communal kitchen area where you can cook your food up. If you're camping, there's often a camp kitchen. But one of the best investments I ever made was my little camp oven that I got from Kmart. I think it was about 20 bucks, $3 for a bunch of canisters, or those butane canisters, and that thing has served me so, so well over the years. I can basically go off the grid and cook whatever I want up on that cooker. So that's another tip. Now the last money saving essential I want to talk about is transport. Take local transport where you can. Buses, trains, tuk-tuks, you'll save a bunch of money rather than spending that on taxis and Ubers, Grabs and the like. An example of this, I was in Flores and I took the BMO bus between most of the major towns all the way across the island. I could be on them for a couple of hours at a time, but they were literally only a couple of bucks to get from place to place. It was pretty squishy. The driving was a bit questionable. One day there was a goat tied to the roof for most of the trip, but it definitely made for an experience and was a lot cheaper than flying from place to place or getting a private car or a taxi. So tip number one kind of turned into 1.1, 1.2, and 1.3, but we are actually up to tip number two now, which is flights and credit cards. I guess seeing as you normally fly into a country at the start of your trip, this maybe should have been tip number one, but it's not, it's tip number two. A few years ago, I read this book, How to Travel the World on $50 a Day by Nomadic Matt. This book inspired me to get a credit card, which to be fair is usually a spending tool, but I was able to save. On my flight from Sydney to Johannesburg in 2019, that flight cost me $71.10 thanks to this credit card. That's just a casual saving of around $1,100. How did I do it, you ask? With a rewards points credit card. A few months before the trip, I did my research and I got this credit card. And if I spent $3,000 in the first 3 months, I would get given 80,000 velocity points. So that could be used on Virgin Australia, Singapore Air flights, and a number of other airlines. So basically what I did was I got this credit card, booked my 5 week trip in Africa, which cost a little over $3,000, and I was able to then book that flight more or less for free. I was gonna book that tour anyway, so it wasn't like I really had to spend extra money to get some other money back. It really ended up being a massive saving and allowed me to do so many extra things in Africa that I probably wouldn't have been able to do if I'd paid full price for a flight. By continuing to accumulate points throughout the year, I was able to get a free flight from Sydney to Auckland. Those points turn into dollars that you can use. To get cheaper flights, I regularly look at websites like Skyscanner and Google Flights, which I can do a nice big comparison before booking a trip from all the airlines and all the destinations. And the good thing with Skyscanner is if you're willing to be a little bit flexible, it'll tell you when and where the cheapest flights are going to be from and to. So if you're a little bit flexible on your destination or your departure dates, you can actually save quite a bit of money, because if you put your destination where I am now, say the Gold Coast, I go down and it shows me which cities are gonna be the cheapest to fly into. Great. Travel with other people. Now I'm gonna contradict this statement straight away by saying most of my travel I have done solo. But when you're doing wildlife-based activities in particular, that can make things pretty expensive. So if you're going with a couple of friends, a partner, or even occasionally on a group tour, you are gonna save a lot of money on those sorts of activities. When I was in Komodo, I had the most incredible trip. Through a guy I met who knew another guy who knew another guy, I was able to actually charter a boat out to Rinsha Island, which was about an hour and a half away from the main town. And that boat cost me about $200 return. They dropped me out one day and then picked me up and brought me back the next day. So this was getting towards the end of my trip, and $200 may sound like a pretty good deal, but if you can imagine, if I was with one other person, it would have been 100 bucks each. If it was four of us, it would have been 50 bucks each. Can see where I'm going here? When I was trekking in Sumatra, I actually went with my mate Ueli, who I'd met earlier in the year. And by going together, we saved around $200 on that tour. And if we were able to get more people, we got advised there would have been an even bigger discount again. Guides need to trek just as far with you or take you to the same place, whether you're on your own, you're with two people or 10 people. So it's definitely worth making a couple of friends while you're traveling or bringing some friends along so you can save money on those sorts of activities. My drink changed, I'm now under coffee. Tip number four is do your research. When it comes to wildlife and adventure travel, usually you are going to have to pay for tours, encounters, and the like. Wildlife tourism is massive, it continues to grow, and it can be quite a daunting topic to research. But if you set your expectations and you more or less know what it is you want to see, it makes that process of researching a lot easier. You'll probably spend a lot of time Googling, but if you spend that time, you'll end up finding really good deals. Example time. While I was in Africa, I wanted to see as much wildlife as possible. Why else do you even go to Africa? But I also had to work on a budget. So I ended up booking a tour with G Adventures, and that's who I was with for the majority of the time I was traveling through Southern Africa. We hit four different countries, and that ended up costing me around $150 a day, which was more than my daily allowance in a lot of other countries, but that included transports, food, accommodation, and basically all the activities, which included safaris, walking with rhinos, national park drives, and a lot of other things too. So when you break it down like that, $150 a day doesn't sound too bad. It included a lot. And a lot of the money handed over for the wildlife-based activities went towards the guides, the communities, the national parks to help maintain this as a sustainable wildlife tourism option. Now, I had researched so many other tours before finally deciding on this one. This one ended up being around a month, and it really covered all the areas that I wanted to see. A lot of the wildlife, there was a high chance of seeing those species in the destinations that we were going, but it also fit my budget at the same time, and you certainly get what you pay for. There are safari companies out there that will charge $1,000 a night, $2,000 a night, and you basically get a personalized one-on-one experience in a private vehicle. You can basically dictate what you want to see, where you want to see it. You'll spend that extra time out there. You go back to your five-star lodge, eat amazing food in the air conditioning. You know, you're getting what you pay for. But my tour, it was a group tour. There were about 18 of us all up. We did have to share accommodation with other people. Accommodation, but we actually camped the majority of the time. We cooked our food communally. A lot of the park drives, it was all 18 of us on the Lando. So if you wanted to spend a bit of extra time watching that elephant or photographing that giraffe, it was kind of a group decision with how long you stayed for and when you left again. But I wouldn't trade that experience for the world. I knew what it was gonna be like because I had taken the time to research and it fit my budget. If I spent $1,000 a day, I literally would have been out of Australia for a couple of weeks because I would have run out of money really, really quickly. So it ticked the boxes, exactly what I wanted. And I saw a whole bunch of incredible wildlife without breaking the bank. Now, you know what's even better than cheap and well-researched experiences? Free ones. There are so many things you can do as a wildlife and adventure traveler that are completely free. Let me rattle a few off for you. Hiking Lion's Head in South Africa, getting nose to nose with wombats in Kangaroo Valley, trekking to waterfalls in the Gold Coast hinterland, chilling with kangaroos on the beach on the south coast. All these experiences, priceless, like literally priceless. All you're paying for is the accommodation, the transport to get there, but the actual experience itself didn't cost a single cent. And I found these places through research. Google, 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 watch a couple of YouTube videos, read a book or read a travel blog. And if you set your expectations, know exactly what it is you want to do, follow it up with that research, you can often find a really cheap or budget-friendly way to do it. Sometimes you'll even get lucky and it'll be completely free. Now my last tip, tip number five, is to embrace volunteerism. I volunteered in several places throughout Southeast Asia, and one thing I've found pretty common to them all is when you dissect the costs, you'll see it's a pretty good deal because it usually includes your food, your accommodation, the volunteer activities you're actually doing, as well as a lot of other little side activities and adventures that you're doing on your days off. I paid an average of $65 per day to volunteer with turtles in Malaysia, but got to do so many other incredible things. As I mentioned, the food was included, accommodation was included. I got to assist in research and monitoring projects for critically endangered sea turtles, see baby sea turtles running down the beach, but I also went snorkeling, hung out on picturesque tropical islands, went hiking around the islands, hung out with the kids at the local school, went and had a home-cooked meal with the local villagers in the kampung. All of this was included, and it wasn't only a way to save a bit of money, but also affordably experience a culture in a bit of a different way. I was on those islands in the Perhentians in Malaysia for about 2 weeks, so rather than just flying in for a couple of days, I really got to experience the culture, meet some incredible people, and ground myself there a little bit, which I think made the experience so much more memorable, which is another benefit of volunteering somewhere for an extended period of time. Now remember, not all of these wildlife projects are created equal. Often the lines can be a little bit blurry when it comes to whether the place is ethical, sustainable, and really doing the best for the communities and of course for the wildlife. So again, it pays to do your research and try and choose somewhere that really aligns with your beliefs. These volunteer projects need more help than ever with the state of the world right now. And if you are researching your next one, definitely feel free to reach out to me. I'm more than happy to give you as many tips and a bit of advice on picking that next one that's going to benefit both you and the project you're going to. Boom! There you have it. Those are my top five tips on how to travel on a budget in 2021 and beyond, both at home and abroad. I sincerely hope that things start to open up a little bit more really soon, but as I have said so many times before, don't be afraid to travel in your own backyard. You can still do it on the cheap and create memories that'll last a lifetime. I hope you enjoyed the video, guys. I certainly enjoyed making it. As you can probably tell, I am still super pumped to travel this year as much as possible, and I hope that you are as well. Be sure to like this video if you enjoyed it, and definitely comment down below. Comment about anything. Ask me questions. We can chat wildlife, travel, content creation, absolutely anything. I really enjoy engaging with you guys, and definitely subscribe as well if you want to see more content like this. Thanks for letting me ramble on, guys, and I'll see you in the next one.